Now, the 13th lecture, which brings this whole series to an end, concerns something that is also important to our development, and that is the question of African time and time management. Well, within this lecture, we want to look at the concept of time, African time, the reality behind the myth, time use and time management. Time as a subject of study, I would say, has excited the interest of scholars since time immemorial. Philosophers are interested in it, scientists are certainly interested in it, theologians, sociologists, and so on and so forth. But you find that time is also considered as a cultural issue, and therefore, it deserves a place in this kind of discussion, especially as it has implications for development. So this thing they call African time, what is it? Related to the question of time being a cultural issue, it is not surprising that terms or notions like African time, colored people's time, and so on have come into existence. But what I find interesting is that there is no comparable reference to American time, or Indian time, or Japanese time, or European time. And why should that be so? I have no answer. What African time means is not entirely too clear. Is it lack of punctuality, misuse and abuse of time? Is it laziness or a lack of time management? Is it lack of interest in the future? Is it inability to establish time frames, or to calculate time? Is it the uncivilized person's attitude and conception of time and its use? It's not clear exactly what people mean by African time. When people talk about African time, they often mean laziness or lack of punctuality. Lateness is viewed as a habit and a cultural habit of Africans. And the resident representative of the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung NGO is very firm in his mind that this is what it is. When he says that maintaining that lateness is a Ghanaian cultural trait challenges all to separate negative traditional practices from positive cultural traits. That indicates clearly that this man is convinced that it is Ghanaians consider lateness as a cultural trait. So all this takes us back to the question of stereotyping the African. There is a view that Africans traditionally, and in fact even now, are careless about time, and they are never on time for events. Now, I think this goes back, it has certain ethnocentric implications. And it goes back to the days when the Negro was stereotyped in a certain way, as superstitious prone, happy-go-lucky, living a carefree life in the jungle, where the Negro relaxes all day long. There's no need to farm, there's no need to cultivate, everything is there. So for this kind of person, as depicted in stereotype, time is certainly unimportant. He lives for the present, and the future takes care of itself from his perspective. So we talk about African time, also Ghanaian time. And this, to me, derives from a perception that African attitudes to time differ from those of Europeans and Westerners. It is assumed that Africans do not do things when they individually feel like it, without reference to when and how long it takes. Africans are said to see time as a resource in abundance and not with no economic value. But the question that we may have to ask is, whose concept of African time are we talking about? As a stereotype, African time is a colonial construct. Europeans coming to Africa for the first time held these views about Africa. What is interesting is that long after colonialism, the notion of African time has survived. and is still current with Westerners and with Africans themselves. And for some, it's another name for lateness. In fact, there is a Ghanaian view of this, okay? And this is a comment taken from the Chronicle, where somebody is talking about Ghanaian attitudes, okay? He says one of the main reasons for the continued underdevelopment of our country is our nonchalant attitude to time. And he says that it seems to be endemic to be late to functions, and we accept it as so. And we explain our lateness by talking about African. We say, oh, it's African time. Okay? And he goes on to say that the higher up one goes on the social ladder, the less punctual one becomes, since the big man is expected to always be the last to come in. So it appears that even Ghanaians are saying that there's something like African time. But is it only Ghanaians? Well, I've referenced to show that even Ivorians also have an idea about African time. The Ivorian idea is that African time exists and that it is killing Africa. That's what the Ivorians are saying. They say that poor punctuality is a brick on Ivory Coast economic development, and that the country has come up with a novel way to combat this issue. And what is their novel way? They have history what they call win a house. If you demonstrate, you can turn up on time. And this is there on the net. So their reference clearly shows that when you talk about African time, it means lateness. This is what tardiness is about. But I would say that the issue is not just about lateness, it's more than lateness. So there's a consequence to African time in business. It definitely accounts for lateness to official functions when activities are regulated by the clock. But bear in mind, regulated by the clock. When events begin late, of course, they close late. All right? Programs, in this case, may be rushed as a result of the late start of events. And when participants don't stick to time, they arrive at different times. Some come early, and the early comers spend long times wasting about and not doing much, waiting for an event to start. And this means what? Reduce productivity. Now, some people may have to leave an activity before or sooner after the beginning, so as to attend some other event or activity, because they have already spent so much time waiting for things to begin. And those who have had to wait for long may show up late the next time, since they wouldn't want to have to wait long times anymore. Some may not even show up at all. It also means that there is lack of quorum. If people cannot come together at the same time to do an activity, it means that activity will not be conducted with a quorum. And business management suffers when we do things without a quorum. We cannot take decisions if everybody is not represented to vote. It also means that deadlines cannot be met, okay? And if deadlines cannot be met, workplace productivity is reduced, it's low. But we may still ask the question, how African is African time? Well, if we say that this is African time, it's traditional African, then the question is, let's go back and look at what happens in traditional African settings or in the informal sector. And anybody who is familiar with African traditional communities will have to realize or already know that these people start work very early. They start at dawn, and they end work very late. You can't say these people are lazy and they are not punctual when they are starting at dawn. And just watch the rural and the urban women, and you will realize that they stick to time. Time is important to them. So it's wrong to say that African time means laziness. It means lateness. No, it doesn't. Now, consider the scheduling of events. In traditional African societies, meetings are scheduled. So how do they do that? appointments are made. So when they are doing that, they consider periods of leisure and convenience. That is the time they exploit for their meetings in the rural settings. And what is even more, if you have work to do, you take it to the workplace. You take it to a meeting place. There's nothing preventing you from taking your baby to a meeting. There's nothing preventing you from taking your basket and continue weaving while you're at the meeting. So nobody's wasting time. Okay? Now, the events themselves, the way they are scheduled, it is true that often it is imprecise. But that imprecision also means flexibility. They may make reference to the elevation of the sun, the moon, whether it is before meals or after meals, which is vague. That is the criteria they use. But in that kind of setting, there's no problem. The venues that we are talking about are informal venues. Maybe it's a domestic setting. It's an open place which is accessible to everybody. Nobody's paying user fees for the use of a conference room. So nobody loses anything if the meeting protracts and takes a long time. And who are the participants? They are usually acquaintances. They know each other. Okay? And when they meet there, those meetings are multi-purpose social events. They are also using this as an opportunity to find out what is happening, exchange information, news, and make this thing, personal contacts, and so on and so forth. Now, in that kind of setting, you don't need a quorum. Quorum is not necessary. So lateness for that kind of setting does not result in economic loss. Now, if the issue is about the informality of it, let us also bear in mind that in this computer age, people now appreciate the benefits of working at home. And when people work at home, they do not maintain office hours. Their productivity is enhanced. Therefore, informality should not imply necessarily low productivity. So if you say in the African system, because it is informal, people are not there, they don't meet in a formal time, they don't have this, therefore there is loss of productivity, think again. Because that informality, the informality that we're talking about in their context, does not lead to economic losses. If anything at all, you could argue that it leads to economic gains. So the other question is, how true is it that punctuality is alien to the African? Well, you could argue that punctuality really is not alien to the African. Because African societies are regulated by their own mechanisms. And these are what determine punctuality. It's not the clock, okay? You're talking about punctuality in terms of the clock. It's the clock that makes someone late by 10 minutes, 20 minutes. It's because you're using the clock. You say, let's meet at 5 o'clock, and some people are not there. These people are not using the clock, okay? So it's not a question of punctuality. It's not alien to them. So what they do is they sound the drum or the gong gong. These are the instruments for bringing people to a central point where they are meeting. Okay? And that is fine for all of them. They can all hear, and they know that, hey, the gong gong is there, so let's all go. So in face-to-face communities, if a particular person is absent or his presence is needed, it's very easy. They just send someone to go and fetch him. The linguist is there for that. The youth are there to go and do the summoning if that is necessary. Okay? Now, when you're talking about all these things, let us also consider the question of indiscipline and the chaos of African modernity. Lateness, the lateness that we attribute to traditional African time has nothing to do with African time at all. It is in fact a function of indiscipline, poor planning, the chaos of African modernity. This is what is bringing it about. So we cannot blame African culture for it. Now, you take the case of the minister who is late for an important meeting with some Deba or whatever. What we have to realize is that this minister or official, his lateness can be explained, maybe due to indiscipline. The man himself is indisciplined. He has got 1,001 clocks. So he knows the time. It's just indiscipline. But it is not always indiscipline. It could also be lack of planning. The person has not planned anything. He failed to realize that if you are traveling from central Accra to Legon, there's traffic, especially at certain times of the year, and that it probably will take you not 5 minutes to get to Legon, it will take you 30 minutes to get there. If you don't plan that way, you get there late. So poor planning. But also the chaos that is surrounding this poor individual who has got to execute many tasks, okay? He's carrying so much responsibility. He's supposed to do so many things at the same time. While he's preparing to come to Legon, the president is calling and is asking questions. He wants to do this, he wants information on this. So is it the man's fault entirely when he gets in there? So that kind of lateness is not a function of African time. It's a function, if anything at all, of carelessness, of indiscipline, lack of planning, and the chaos of the modernity that applies to us. You come from Accra to Legon, should be a short distance. Maybe you can do it in 15 minutes. But you can't do it because of the roads, which are choked. Okay? It's the modernity which is to blame for this. And this is precisely what somebody has said, commenting on this. Somebody from a Kenyan in Germany said, he says, unpunctuality can sometimes be attributed to don't care attitude, while in other cases, factors beyond an individual's control can result in lateness. Unreliable public service vehicles, traffic jams, poor roads are just but some of the factors that could lead to one's arriving late for an important function. So it's not just the culture. There's something else that accounts for it. But African culture takes a beating, becomes the alibi for all these things. But let us look at time in African cultures. Definitely, the Akan practice illustrates what Africans know about time, what they do about time. There is definitely a concept of time among Africans, even the colonial times. Okay? The only thing is that that concept differs from the Western concept of time. That is just it. So Africans, for example, did not numericalize time segmentation. And they didn't do that consistently. Africans did not have chronometers, watches, sundials, and whatnots that are calibrated equally to measure time intervals. They didn't have that, okay? The nearest to that was maybe the length of the shadow, okay? Which, of course, was never graduated mathematically or numerically, okay? But they didn't have ways and means of segmenting time. For example, it's true that they didn't have a concept of the watch, I mean the second, the minute, the hour. They didn't know these things. They didn't have them. They didn't need them. Okay? And therefore, there are no indigenous words in African languages for these concepts. When the Europeans brought this with colonization, they had no other choice but to invent words for that. In the Hausa language, the word for a clock is agogo, okay? And agogo is not really a traditional word that the Hausas had. In some northern Ghanaian societies, the word for clock or for hour simply means metal rod. That is because the British in those, the colonial officials sounded the metal rod to let people know that it was 1 o'clock, it was 2 o'clock. If the thing hit three times, then it was 3 o'clock. Four times, 4 o'clock. So the clock was known as the metal, and the hour hand was known as metal. So because iron rods were being used for that. But they didn't have a concept of weeks and months. They also segmented the day into dawn, morning, mid-morning, afternoon, late afternoon, evening, night, midnight, and so on and so forth, depending on the culture. Some had a concept of the week, which was X days for the week, depending on the culture, some 7 days, some 6 days, some 3 days. For example, in some parts of Ghana, the Maka cycle was their idea of a week. So they made appointments taking into account the Maka cycle, okay? Of course, they were not concerned about how many whether weeks were translating to months. They didn't work that out. They didn't need that, okay? But there was a concept of a month measured and I was based on observations of the moon, its phases, and so on and so forth. There was a concept of a year. For some, the year was like half a year. That is a season. Every season was a year. But there was a concept. Many a time, these people saw time in terms of something that is cyclic and repetitive. But really, if you look at it from a certain perspective, there are commonalities between the African way and the European way. In other words, all of these are dependent to a certain extent on environmental phenomena and changes, except that the African societies did more of this than the European systems. Okay? So, for example, as atmospheric changes were important, the movement of the sun, the moon, the stars, these were all indicators of time. But the behaviors of certain birds and mammals were important. The cock, for example, will crow at dawn. The dove will coo in the afternoon to show people that it was afternoon time. So they knew from the environment. The sighting of certain migratory birds would tell them that, look, it has, the season for doing this has arrived. The flowering of certain fruits, fruit trees, or grasses, or species were very important. So they definitely have a concept of African year, and that is where the festivals come in. The Homo festival, the Kundun festival, Adakoya festival, Ojira festival, and so on and so on. These are all markers of time, okay? But beyond that, people had other indicators for time. Of course, the African system had its own shortcomings. It lacks precision, that is true. So when you want to apply this in the modern business setup, of course, things will not work out. But you don't need to, okay? In the modern business operates by clock time, so use your clock, okay? But it also means that when you are trying to establish the periodicity for certain events historically, it becomes difficult. Establishing age, for example, if you want to know how old an African is, it becomes problematic because there is no indication, clear indication, as to how, when the person was born, how old the person is, and so on and so forth. Often what we do is, when we go to the field, researchers who want to measure people's ages, we are forced to listen to them telling us that the time, what important events historically were taking place at the time of their birth. Floods, fire outbreaks, the visits of important heads of state, and so on and so forth. Researchers, to a certain extent, are handicapped when it comes to depending on the African way of getting this done properly. But the question that has always been asked is it also an issue of monetization? Is that why we Africans do not keep the time? Okay? And somebody actually believes that, look, 90% of the problem can be solved when Africans are put on wages instead of monthly salaries. Then time will be of essence to them. Maybe we should do that. Okay, now that we are not longer in the traditional time, we are more living in the modern time, let them live by wages and not by this thing. Just pay people whether they work or not, okay? So it's true that taxi drivers in Ghana know that their livelihood depends on the number of trips that they make. And these people are very busy, okay? Their day starts very early and closes very, very late. Okay, and they are punctual. Okay, they are always in a hurry. The only problem is that that hurry also endangers life. So migrant Africans in Europe and in the West, for example, are known to work so hard, and they are time conscious because they know time is money. Okay, clearly then, lateness and the lack of consciousness to time have nothing at all to do with African concepts of time. But having said all this, it is also important to ask ourselves whether time is the only thing that matters. Sometimes punctuality is good, but we cannot be slaves to time. And that is also true from a sociological perspective, depending on the context. We sometimes need time for ourselves, you know? If you go to a family meeting, you don't start looking at your watch and, you know, you're not supposed to, you pretend that the watch doesn't exist. You don't ask time, you don't look for that. Yeah, because that kind of context also requires that you leave aside the clock. But if you go into a modern environment where you are talking about modern business, the clock stands. So it's for you to make that distinction and know that these are different arenas, okay? In fact, protocol sometimes demands that certain things be done or be seen to be done, not hurriedly, or with reference to the clock, but just do things the way they should be done. If you take, for example, the case of modern weddings, you ask yourself, why is it that the bride-to-be is always late for the event, but the groom is never kept, is not supposed to keep the bride waiting? Why is that so? Really, if you study all this, you are left with no other conclusion but that in these kinds of cases, in the case of the bride, lateness is symbolic, okay? Lateness in the wedding settings is symbolic. It is telling everybody something. We're not going to go into that. So the conclusion then is that, as traditionally conceptualized in Africa, time differs from the Western concept. And it differs essentially because Western time is regulated by watches and chronometers. And therefore, when there's deviations, then we can talk about lateness. But that has nothing to do with African time. Many Africans now use clocks and watches. They are not ignorant of the time or its implications. So if they are late for events, it has nothing to do with African time. It is they themselves who are to blame for it. So time may not be everything at all times. In the informal sector, in domestic life, strict adherence to time may not be important. But in the formal settings, time management becomes something which is very, very important. So it is a question of making a distinction between the two arenas of behavior. So there's something that students may like to read, which is written by Tom Markowski on time and the calendar in 19th century Ashanti. There are other materials that are available on the subject on Sakai.